This ain't fun. You guys, come on.
Okay, sir, first question is, recently we've just been hearing complaints on lack of parties. What is Bronycon going to do to increase the number of fun for the 21 and older crowd?
We're going to throw more fun in our opening ceremony speech.
But how will that equal to more parties?
Because it's fun.
Good question. Good answer.
To answer your question seriously, I mean, we mostly cater to all ages, and that kind of limits us in a bit of that. However, that's one of the reasons why we have the Brony Bar Trot, and clearly that's a super popular thing. I know last year
there was not enough cute girls there.
There are not enough cute girls anywhere.
Well, I can't help you on that. That's basically all objective. So, I mean, it is.
That actually works. That's a good quote. That's a good motto.
One cute girl at a time, yeah.
Oh, by the way, this guy is one of our attendees. He came up to me earlier yesterday. Just wanted to know things about, you know, what it's like being a con chair. So I work with Josh here to let him come in if he had any questions. Feel free to pipe up at any time. Any questions, we could definitely answer them for you.
Any other press people have any questions before I ask?
How tough is dealing with the logistics of running a con outside the con? You know, so the city, fire, I guess noise control, and, you know.
So it's actually...
in a city that's probably as corrupt as The Wire.
working with the city is actually a lot smoother than it seems, because for as much as there is many of us, for a point-to-point contact between us and the city, there are as many as there are of them, plus more. So they are super well aware of all the details of our event. They keep us briefed on anything that is supposed to be happening around the city. We have contacts with the city of Baltimore, not just the tourism district, the Baltimore Police Department, which then also gets us, you know, ambulances, our paramedics, as well as fire department. And then also Downtown Coalition, which is the people that you typically see as you're walking down the Inner Harbor, who are there to answer questions for our attendees. The logistics, it seems like it's daunting at first, especially if you're just going into it, but it's almost relatively simple. They just need to know what's going on at your event, and then they schedule everything on their end and just let you know that it's scheduled.
Alright, fire away. Okay, so excuse the nerdy reference, but if Bronycon were, say for instance, the Star Trek Enterprise, who are the people you have on deck, on command deck, and how many people, how many red shirts, how many people do you have, like, keeping the Enterprise going?
Okay, are we doing original series Star Trek Enterprise, which was the pre-sequel to...
I've only seen the movies, so I...
Get out.
I know.
Yeah, that movie from 99. How about that?
Get out.
No.
Generations does not exist. No,
yeah, Star Trek Generations.
Basically,
no, there's the final frontier.
Departments,
Star Wars,
like,
awesome.
The people who do, like, the major... What the fuck? Thing, and then how many, like, how big is the army, the legion you need to support an operation like Bronycon?
So you're talking, like, from a staffing point, like, what departments do we have to handle everything?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a little bit easier, because when you do, putting the nerd cap back on, because when you try to do, like, Star Trek, you got your red shirts, your yellow shirts, and your blue shirts,
right, yeah.
And it's really tough to, with the exception of medical, it's really difficult to, like, try to shoehorn everybody into those departments.
Right.
Trust us, we've tried, and trying to do it is difficult, but we have... 9 departments total, 10 if you include the chairs. They are convention operations, design, who are here, events, finance, public relations, who is also here, obviously, registration, security, vendor relations, and VIP relations. Fulner and I manage a grand total of 18 people directly, and underneath them is about 400 staff. Actually 400 plus staff. We have about 400 who are here on site, not all of them necessarily make it, because we have some staff from all around the world. Some of them are able to make it, like one of our design staff lives in Australia, he comes every year, and Belgium. Oh, it's, yeah, because us only having to manage 18 people makes our lives really easy. The big secret is just delegation.
Right.
Quick question. This question comes from all the way from Korea, from
general.
What's for dinner?
Ooh, man. You know what I could go for right now? Since he's in Korea, I could go for bibimbap. That sounds really good. Tell him you should get some bibimbap.
How do you spell it?
B-I-B-M-B-O-P.
Bibimbap?
In Rocksteady, yes.
No, it's B-I-B-I-M-B-O-P.
B-I-M-B-O-P.
Yeah, bibimbap.
That sounds like that kind of the verse from Hansen's bibimbap.
It's super tasty. It's rice, vegetables, and this beef that's seasoned in a really specific way. It's super, super tasty.
I've got a question for Feulner. Do you still have nightmares about pineapples?
Of course pineapples have come up.
Yeah.
No, I don't have nightmares about pineapples. But
not anymore.
The taste of pineapple sometimes causes me to have flashbacks to that evening.
PTSD, huh?
I blame Screw Loose. Hmm. It's his fault. He did this to me.
You're the one who decided to do it, though.
Listen, it's there. I can't stop.
Right.
It was a panel.
Sure was. That's for certain. No one's forgetting that one.
Another question. A lot of people in the writer's circuit have kind of had some complaints about sort of there's basically nobodies, and I know, and it's not that's not how they put it, but it's basically people who are not really well versed in writing panels. I was wondering what could your reaction to that be?
Well, I mean, our events team is the one who does all of the vetting for panels. Really, it's a matter of who opts to fill or basically apply for panels. With some rare exceptions, we ask that everybody apply for panels rather than us, you know, go out and actively seek tons of people to do it. Sometimes we switch it up and we have a million fanfic panels that get submitted to us, thank you. And sometimes we try to get them to go and come together so they can do one panel, that way we don't just have one day where it's how to write a fanfic panel times 5, times 10, times 20. Basically, we try to work to consolidate it a bit.
And I think to build off of that as well, too, is it's quite possible, I'm not entirely sure about who reads fanfictions on our event staff, but it's quite possible that we may not have someone who's well-versed in all the fanfictions in the fandom, and that can be causing, you know, like, oh, hey, this panel sounds more interesting, let's go ahead, maybe they haven't done one yet, so let's put them in. I mean, it's obviously up to events, like Josh was saying. But, you know, if anyone who wants to volunteer to help do that with VC to make sure we get some quality writing panels, just let our events team know. I'm sure they would definitely be welcome to that.
Yeah, we basically we have people who work on specific tracks. The one you're talking about is the writing track. And then we have liaisons for panels to do that. Our events team is always looking for volunteers. We should have our volunteer form up probably a month after the event or so, for people who would like to try to fill in those shoes. If you happen to know anybody.
Yeah, you're staring at my badge. I know, you see the confab. I know. Another question is, there's also been another call, like a major call, to get the ice cold water guy for the opening ceremonies. any news on that guy?
So, fun fact, we were actually supposed to have him for a panel last year. He totally agreed to do it. He was going to do it with, I believe, Saber Spark and Race Best. They came up to us and said, hey, we want to get this guy a badge and we can have him come up. He said it was okay. And we did. We got him a badge. But he ultimately had to turn it down because he was a little too busy selling his dollar cold wares on the streets. To which, can't blame him. I mean, makes a damn good living off
Man's
the
got hustle. Yeah. Man's got to make a hustle, make a living, you know?
Are we referring to the gentleman who sells ice cold water out here in the war?
Yep.
Yeah, it's like ice cold water, only $1.
So now we have a cool.
Yeah, our attendees love him, which is really great because it ended up, it was a real big thing for Otakon. And we had a feeling like Otakon would be like, no, that's our thing. And Otakon's Baltimore to go to DC to even care, so we totally got him instead. And that's cool because our fandom really seems to love him and loves drawing art for him.
Oh, what was this
about?
Oh,
dang. That's the X. Yeah. At the end of the panel, there's supposed to be a slime, like, you get slime.
As soon as someone says, I don't know.
I've always wanted to be slime.
What is that, the Nickelodeon show?
Yep, yeah. You can't do that in Hillary.
It's basically Nickelodeon in the 90s.
What is that?
After that, it sucks.
Figure it out. That's the name of the Nickelodeon show.
Sorry. It was just there and it bothered me.
Hang on, I'm still making tweets about this.
So,
can I ask another question?
Yeah.
Oh, you go ahead.
Oh, okay.
You're good.
So, I'm pretty sure I know the answer to this, but I want to hear it from you guys. How much time do you have to prepare in advance for Brony? Like, basically, how much downtime do you get from end of this con until the next con? And then bonus, like, what would you say is like your work flow from beginning to end? Like, starting off like 25% of the con, what is that 90% before the con?
So honestly, what's going to happen this year is I'm going to go to all of my staff, or the majority of them, and tell them that they need to take a week off before starting to think about 2016. I'm getting some head shaking already, and I know not everybody's going to do it. Yeah, some departments have already started already planning for 2016, which is really good because we asked them to. Some departments it's a little bit more difficult because they have way too much stuff on their plate going up to this. It's really a year-round thing. I don't think I've had a break since August 2012. Then we basically do this all the time. I mean, we have like days where we take some downtime for ourselves and whatnot, but basically it's, since it's all volunteer, we go about our lives, we do our jobs, and then after our jobs are over, we have con work to do. One of the reasons why, because as you might know, Bronycon used to be a 2-a-year convention, and before that was a 4-year convention.
I heard about that when I was reading
the Ever again?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Not now.
It takes a full year plus to prepare for Bronycon, just in terms of everything that needs to be done, all the little details, all the big details, just getting everything ready in order to make it the experience that it is for everybody. It's well worth it, I think. And since none of my staff have up and quit, I'm assuming they think it's worth it too.
It's only because they tolerate you.
Yeah, I'm a pretty tolerable person.
Sometimes, yeah.
So the just quick follow-up on the thing you just said, I hope it's okay if I ask this, so that when you say volunteer, basically no one here sees money from the con, like the money goes back into next year or goes to charity?
All of the money we have goes towards the con. Any revenue that we make from the year before goes directly into our next year's events. Sometimes we have a little bit overflow, which goes back into our NPO's coffers for rainy day or emergencies.
Oh, you're talking about Lunar Solace.
Yeah, Lunar Solace, which is the parent company of Bronycon.
So you don't waste it on hookers and blow?
No hookers and blow.
Why not?
I keep asking for a segue and I don't get it.
Yeah.
I want a segue, so
you can walk.
Go around the con.
You can walk, young man.
Well, that's really admirable that you do all this work for volunteers. That's just fantastic.
Well, it's worth it to me for like the thousands and thousands of people here who are having a good time.
Yeah.
That's worth it for me.
As cheesy as it sounds, I get paid in smiles.
Yeah. I should get you a button.
With a sad clown.
I really wish I wasn't here right now.
You had a question.
Did I? Oh, that's right. So moving from Secaucus to here, what were the other two venues that were in the running? Because I think it was DC and Boston.
It was Pittsburgh and Boston.
Oh, why?
It was one of the top three in terms of like what they were going to give us for moving.
We had proposals out to several cities outside of those two, but
we focus mainly on like the Northeast region
because
we know that moving from New Jersey to New York City, so Baltimore was just kind of really awesome in terms of the deal that they gave us for moving here, as well as it's not too far from New York City for our original attendees, which when we made the original move, of course, it caused a little bit of backlash, but Baltimore has seemed to open us up with
anyway.
Pretty open arms. It's been fantastic.
Fun fact, we were One of the reasons why we didn't end up going with them was because they would not respond to our proposal, and we didn't want to work with a city that would basically just freeze us out. Turned out to be for the best, though, because at that time we were thinking we were just going to, you know, grow 2,000 people, 6,000, and that would have been a good fit. Then we grew 8, and I know that city has problems already being able to store enough people for Anthrocon as it is, and they're quickly trying to build hotels, not just for that, but for everyone else in order to add, you know, additional tourism.
The convention center is big enough for the folks, there's just nowhere to stay.
Yeah, exactly. And we would have been screwed easily, but thankfully it happened, and here we are in our lovely city of Baltimore.
I don't know, I've been in the city.
I used to live here.
Everybody's angry. That's all I gotta say, all the locals are angry.
It's the Ravens fans. That's
the it's the Ravens fans.
By the way, Dean, did you get my photo that I sent you?
Which one?
The one me flipping off the Camden Yards while I was driving by.
Oh, I totally did. Go O's. Unfortunately, one of my staff has my O's cap, so we'll have to get a picture of us going like that later.
Especially since they're playing today.
Yeah. Not here, though, which is super sad.
I know.
This is the first year since we've been here that the Orioles aren't playing a home game.
Which sucks because it's also the Angels. We could have went in there, you know, just start drinking and start yelling at each other.
Yeah, well, there's always time for that, regardless of the O's are playing.
No, I'm glad I didn't get a room at the Hilton. all the past few years, I've gotten a room at the Hilton with the stadium. It was like, oh, wow, empty stadium. I'm glad I'm at the Marriott.
Welcome, by the way.
Hi.
I saw you come to Camden and Lane and wanted to say hi.
Yeah, I didn't want to interrupt you guys or anything
like
that. Oh, by all means. Yeah,
excuse
me.
You asked him that like 3 days ago, dude. Or like yesterday.
Was he there with him?
Yeah, you were there. You asked him to do the same
thing. I don't
remember. You're drunk all the time.
I wasn't drunk.
Bullshit.
I just fell asleep. I was tired.
I was exhausted.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. I was exhausted.
Drinking my green tea that's totally out of your bottle.
Oh, man. I should tell you the guy about his green tea obsessions.
Long as Nonicon's violating any of their branding in terms of like, you know, like, hey, we're going to go ahead and sell Hasbro licensed merch and for everybody. And we try to be close to Hasbro or anything like that. I mean, obviously, we go out there, we request certain things to do, get permission or approval. But right now, pretty much, if they acknowledge that Brony conventions exist, it might hurt them. So they're kind of just like, it's a very gray area.
So what would be an example of something you would have to ask permission for? Like the video you guys made?
Obviously, streaming an episode. If we wanted to like put an episode out, we would have to get permission.
Actually, not even from Hasbro. That would be from Discovery Communications.
Yeah, because we worked through Hasbro before, but Discovery Communications now does all of the show stuff.
Right.
Which, thankfully, because they're a lot easier to work with, they're a lot more communicative because it's a degree of separation. As Fuller said, they blind eye things because, I mean, truth be told, when you think about it, all these conventions, Bronycon, Equestria LA, Everfree Northwest, BabsCon, etc., it is free marketing for them. So it is, in my eyes, it seems like it's in their best interest for these to happen.
Right.
But the minute that they have to acknowledge everyone and say, hey, these are pony conventions, they have to start enforcing strict rules. There was a bit of an issue earlier this year amongst the fandom with a guy named Trace Ponies, Neil.
You're all welcome, by the way.
Where we had a lot of attendees coming to us saying, coming to me at least saying, obviously you guys should be working with Hasbro in order to make sure that nothing like this ever happens. And my favorite thing to do is to take them to Oticon's website and I show them their Artist Alley guidelines, which are probably at least 4 pages long of don'ts. You can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can do this, but only if you don't do that. And in a world where Hasbro has a lot more of a presence in all of these, in the pony community, there would be a lot of that in our vendor halls, and we would probably end up having to turn away tons and tons of vendors, which we don't want to do. They don't want to do, which is why all of that is the way it is. The downside to a lot of that is a lot of the things that non-pony conventions get, in terms of things like exclusives, etc., cetera, that you might see at, like, say, San Diego Comic-Con or other Comic-Cons, most pony conventions can't get, because suddenly you have the zeroth degree of separation, which is against what they want. It's also one of the reasons why if you go to a convention, you don't see Interplay, you see Pack Breakers. You don't see We Love Fine, you see Sugar's Cube Corner. You are dealing with their official resellers who go to these events. That way, there is one degree of separation.
That's cool. I have a question about security.
Yes.
So the security situation here is a little more in depth than I was expecting. So you've obviously got your con security, and you've got your convention hall security, which seems to be contracted out of the convention. And then you also have the Baltimore Police Department, who I guess aren't in their formal uniforms, they're just wearing their black t-shirts, so the police on the back, and they're remaining outside the convention. Were you guys involved in much of that, besides just like setting up their own security staff?
So there's a, I can answer all of those. So what we have is we have actually three layers of security. We have our volunteer security and medical teams. Our medical people are all EMTs. We wouldn't allow them on our medical team unless they were due to liability reasons, and we have to insure them for our event.
Is there like a minimum classification that they need to be?
Yes, and I don't actually have that answer off the top of my head.
It would be EMT basic. As long as you have an EMT certification. We work with a risk management team. Our EMTs are very limited in what they can do in response, and that's what our risk manager is for. He basically says, okay, you can do this, but for anything else, we should go ahead and call an ambulance. That's why you'll see basically when someone is down for heat exhaustion and things like that, it'll be an ambulance to come in, because if we start helping them out, the liability comes on to us. I mean, we're happy to help them out, but you know, in a day, unfortunately, where legality and litigation is pretty serious, you know, we want to keep going on, so we just need to be careful and, you know, take care of our attendees at the same time, which our EMTs and our risk manager are very fantastic at doing. Continue with your layers of security.
Bronycon security is like onions.
Sort of. I mean, you're not necessarily wrong with that, though. So there's one of them, there's two of them we control, one of them we do not. So our volunteer staff, you see all around here in blue shirts, light blue shirts, as opposed to the purple like she is wearing back there, of that color. Those are our volunteer staff. We have about 140 of them, I want to say. Maybe 100, no, it's a little less than that.
Security?
Yeah.
Okay. You segued from staff.
Well, yeah, I'm talking about for security. There's about 140 of them for three shifts of the event.
Yeah.
We then have our black shirts, which is security that is contracted through us that we are required to have through the Baltimore Convention Center. We tend to use them for badge checks at all the major halls. We also have them for overnight security in all of the halls as well, in order to have, they can talk to them. It's just kind of like a, especially with everything that happened in April here in Baltimore, it's just the city of Baltimore saying, we'd like to provide a little bit extra for you guys.
So they're not actually contracted either with the convention hall staff or with you guys.
They
have a protective duty assignment.
So they work with the Baltimore Convention Center themselves,
okay,
in order to do that. It's not just them coming.
Yeah, they don't just show up and kind of do
yeah,
that.
It is coordinated.
Okay.
Security, a lot more complex than you would think.
How about security outside the convention? Because, you know, there's a lot of shady people in Baltimore.
We raised those concerns last year, mainly after we had some reports of some stuff that attendees had some problems with panhandlers and things like that. And we talked with Visit Baltimore, and that's kind of why you see with the BCC, with the off-duty police officers, you'll see there are a lot more of the red vests, or the red shirts, and I believe the safety vests all throughout the inner harbor. They're there for the attendees, kind of just keep an eye. They're all radioed some way or form, and it's the downtown coalition that Josh had brought up earlier. Basically, they know we're here, and we said, you know, hey, we want to make sure that there are, you know, people every little bit, so if an attendee has a problem, they can run up to them, say that they need help, and then they will contact us, and then we'll contact the appropriate people to take care of a situation like that.
So the red vests are this other layer of security.
There's a red. Those are people that work in the downtown area. Right. They're kind of like the cleaners and the trash picker. Like they're in the Inner Harbor area more specifically.
Yeah,
kind of like tourism people.
Yeah. Okay.
They're all radioed. I know there's two color shirts. Can't remember the other one, but basically they have
the yellow one. Right?
Yes.
The traffic.
Yeah, that's the traffic ones.
But the red ones are there. I forget they had a really cool name for them, but they're there kind of just for people that are tourists. They keep an eye out for everything. So
at a less expensive rate, as well as our attendees, which is one of the reasons why it's a big boon. We also have a lot of our staff that lives within a tri-state area of here. I always forget how small these states are because I'm from Wisconsin, and that's a big state, which can probably fit about a good chunk of the northeastern part of America.
Should look at Texas.
I think that's about out of California.
I've driven California. I can agree with that.
I just live an hour and a half away in Virginia.
But we do have a lot of attendees, or excuse me, staff on the eastern side of Pennsylvania, Massachusetts, Maryland, as well as more additional states within a good 100-mile radius where it's really effective for them to drive. A lot of them do still fly because it's quicker and it's less of a hassle than having to drive, park, etc. So it played a bit of a consideration for staff. I think it played a bigger consideration for attendees because our attendees obviously come from all across the world. So as I mentioned, it is a bit cheaper to fly here, but the area around here, in terms of attendees, we have our potential attendees. There is a huge pocket of people who would come to our event in this entire northeastern area. That's a lot easier to get to than as opposed to Pittsburgh, because then you got to do I-80, and let me tell you,
it's a lonely, lonely road.
It is. I've done the pike. Turnpike.
Pike was big when it was first introduced way back when. I don't think
it's definitely not. It's definitely a thing you do once and then never again.
Yeah, we went from where I live in Virginia to Chicago. That long stretch of I-80 across Ohio. I was like, there's nothing here.
Oh, no, you should go from L.A. all the way to San Francisco, down the Central Valley.
Oh, that's where I-90 turns into I-80.
Mm.
Farms, as far as the eye can see.
I did that drive in 2 hours.
That's lovely shit.
I come from Cleveland, so I passed through all of them.
Tell you one thing, I-5 from Seattle to Vancouver is a really nice drive, though.
It's a beautiful drive.
Oh, yeah.
We're not Detroit.
Well, the thing is about this area, too, not only do I have BWI, but also have IED and DCA as, like, other choices, so.
Don't have a panic phase, just something
yeah.
I don't know if that was mine or not.
Nope, mine's on silent.
Is that my room? I did it. Okay, that is me.
Considering that is there, it's kind of deadly.
Faulner is never deadly. He just
I'm talking about the situation.
Oh, he just short and silent.
Short and silent. Oh, yeah. Nice.
This is Josh Rabbi. I'm in a press session. Can I help?
We're all gonna die.
The vendor pulls on Faulner's right next to me.
Please don't tell me that's one of my guys.
He's not answering his phone.
Before June, Bronycon 2012, I had a nightmare once about a fire.
Okay, two out of three, you know how this works.
Oh, damn it.
One, two, three, shoot. Right.
Wait.
I know your tricks now.
Okay, can you tell me what's going on here?
I need to go talk to some of my staff. One of us is needed.
Shit's going down, dude.
But how does that work? Like, you guys just choose who gets to go up there?
No, Fulner can let you know more about how things work with that as I cross my rock paper. We just started doing that this year.
So whenever we get a call that security needs one of us, either just to have a presence or something like that, we play rock, paper, scissors if we're both together, because sometimes one of us is just like, I don't
want to. Yeah, typically it's one of us, always one of us has to go.
So official. Well.
It was a pleasure talking to you guys.
Yes,
yeah.
Thank you, Josh.
Have a great time.
Thank you.
Oh, by the way, I'll see you at the mixer
tonight.
Yeah, I have to explain the Bronycon RJ.
No.
All right, take care, guys.
It's a funny story.
I don't care.
It never happened. It's fine. They created the rumors from Kickstarter.
Now Cahill, now he's gone. What's it like working under Josh Jean, the evil emperor?
All right, everybody, get your questions out now.
Yeah.
Hang on. When they were
The evil overlord, Josh Dean.
Big bad Josh Dean.
Yeah.
He's a big guy.
According to him, he's Josh Dean. At least that's what his Twitter says.
I'm Josh Dean. Oh, I'm Josh Dean. I'm Spartacus.
Hey, it's Josh Dean.
Out of all of the departments, which one would you say gives you the most amount of work where you have to spend the most amount of time getting it right in order to prevent the possible headaches?
Okay, so I thought it was going to start. I'd be like, who's your best department? And then it would turn into, like, who do you think needs the most work?
Security.
No, it's a really tough question, I'm not going to lie. Every department, I mean, it's, I love to say, like, we're like a family. Families have, you know, disputes. They have little things that they miss out on. Other departments. Basically, everyone has a good point. Everyone has a point where it's like, all right, where's next year? I would say in terms of one who makes me do the most work, it is security, because they're the ones who call me during the con to go do things. Like security should. Design called me to make me do work. I would be sad, design. Like last year. Older, I need you to go pick up all those t-shirts and posters. I just like it. Yeah, it's crap. I didn't crush you with boxes. I just packed them really well. Oh, that's when I took really sharp turns.
Our Tetris?
Question. There's been a lot of jokes about this, I think, but I'm wondering if, you know, has any... deodorant companies came to you and said, hey, we would like a booth here at Bronycon.
It's called Speed 6, not expensive.
Actually, no. It would not. But we actually try to reach out to a partnership with Purell, because hand sanitizers are really actually awesome. But the Baltimore Convention Center has them around.
Yeah.
Just because it's just nice to help curb the con crud. I hate it. I don't want it. This con is the only con that gives it to me.
That sounds ludicrous.
I think it's Baltimore.
Yeah, it's Baltimore.
Sure. Yeah, it's Baltimore.
I try not to work at other cons. I try to attend other cons. LPU kind of ruined that.
That reminds me, will you be wearing a fursuit this year?
Oh man, the question finally came up.
Yeah.
Maybe tonight.
Mr. Anthrocon.
The word furry it came is not sounding too good right now.
Is it straight up furry or is it like pony furry?
Oh, he's furry.
Just you straight out of
yeah,
it.
He's furry. Look at the beard. Look at that.
Oh, what? No.
The silly neck beard. Aren't you
Was not a
I know.
Because it's actually well kept.
Yeah. So it's a fox, right? Isn't it something like that?
Yeah.
Let me find your other Twitter name.
Okay, when I did it the fox say? I did it.
Oh, shut up.
Well, okay, I gotta ask. This is now an ask a furry panel.
Yep.
Why do everybody have to have personas of either a wolf, a rabbit, or not rabbit, a fox, or any other predatory animal?
So let me tell you.
Is that a predator?
You install furry.exe.
What?
Your default, it's a computer joke. If you install furry, or basically you just go, all right, I'm gonna be a furry now, and you're just like, all right, what am I gonna do? The default answer is usually fox. Why? Because of all the movies that came out during our childhood. It's not even a
Fox and the Hound, Robin Hood, Robin Hood especially.
For me, it was Star Fox. That's why. Other people.
Come on,
leave me alone. I really like that game.
I don't care.
I'm also really excited for the new one coming
out. I don't care about that either.
But yeah, I think that's it. So I'll be a shameless person.
Did you enjoy going to Anthrocon?
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
It's a fun convention.
I didn't see you at all, which is both. Bothered me a little because I was sad.
Why didn't you tweet me?
I did. You ignored me.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, dude, it's like, oh, I'm an Anthrocon. I'm not falling her down. This Abel Fox guy, whatever. I don't know.
Going away from the furry fandom.
No, we're gonna stick to furries.
There is a point where we shouldn't have crossed it.
Here
we
go. Yes, Abel Fox.
Let's keep going.
We have good integration. Good
crossover. No, we don't. Furries hate it when there's like, we're not bronies.
Well, I will say that there are a shitload of furries here. Though.
Oh yeah.
More and more diverse amount of furries than I think I've normally ever seen any of the furries before. So I'm not sure how that came about, but whatever. I am kind of interested in about the layout of the con, because I know that most of the biggest change for the convention, just from traffic-wise, has been like the cutting off that entire section. The fact that the vendor hall is now merged with those two other little areas, and it has a one-way in, one-way out system.
Mm-hmm.
So, how did you guys go through the process of setting up the new layout?
So it was a little bit of give and take. With another event happening here this weekend, we had the floor space, we had the 300 level as halls over on the other side of the convention center where they are. For me, that was like the best. I mean, yeah, it was a little bit of a longer walk, but it was more centralized. I mean, this layout's also more centralized, but like when people try to go to the vendor hall, Hoofbeats Underground and Harmony Plaza, which I believe are halls F, G, and they're connected to Hall E, which is where I believe registration, I always get the layouts mixed up, but they're connected, but it's just that weird area where you have to enter in from the Honor Bee lobby. There's the other one where you have to leave out next to registration. Our vendor team really liked that because it's just it's a nice flow, mainly because you have people coming in and they have to, it makes them kind of go around the whole area.
Yeah.
Last year we had an in and an out, but there were booths on a corner that just didn't get high traffic. So it was more of an optimization for them as well. And this also, we were kind of stuck with the side of the convention center, so we made the best as we could. When I say stuck with, we had very good options. We worked with the event folks. It's just like, hey, if we give you these, will you give us that? So that's how we got most of the 300 level. And I think it would be really fantastic if that, like, there's like a dead zone of entrances. If that could be fixed, it'd be great. Or maybe inter-hall traffic would be cool. But that's kind of how it was for our layouts this year.
All right, filter. From Abel Fox, what is it like to be afraid?
I think it'd be awesome.
I swear, if it's Abel, so help me.
It's Abel Fox, yeah. It's Abel.
I'm gonna find. Hold on,
IT journalist.
If it's the Abel that I know, I'm gonna tell him that he's a butt face. Yes, he's a butt face.
Yeah.
Just respond with, "You're a butt face."
IT journalist, Motorola radio specialist, Fox and Fixer.
Yeah. More of a cat. No, seriously, don't. Hello.
So I don't know if this is taboo to ask, but I'm really curious. The whole package deal, what is the price sticker on Bronycon? You had to pile all the cash in one corner and say that's how much it takes to do this.
$1 million.
What brilliant.
No, thank God. This is why I wish Josh was here, because
Well, you're the one who won rock, paper, scissors.
Yeah, this isn't your grave.
You should have gone to deal with Rabbi.
It depends on
the
budget for a year.
He's going to look like Badge eventually today.
It can cost.
Or never.
At least if we were to just say flat out cost with the convention center, with everything, it's in upwards of $500,000 to $600,000. And that's just paying all the bills. That's not counting, any of the revenue that we get in. The revenue fluctuates depending on the super awesome stuff we have in the swag shop to the things that people buy. But that's kind of it. BC is an expensive con.
I think
our department heads can definitely say that we are really stingy with budgets.
they don't pay for your mocha frappa tea.
Don't pay for travel.
Your t-shirt. It's not t-shirt.
Huh?
Let's just call your T-shirt, because I don't know what
that is. T-shirt? Yeah, that's a good term. Yeah. Owner's T-shirt.
All right.
Will there be any more piles this convention? Or
what?
Any fur piles?
No.
Why not? With, pony cosplayers and fur seats. Come on. That's good.
No.
Why not?
No.
You're into that, right?
No.
Why not?
Because I choose not to be.
I thought you were.
Just be like, enough of this, your badge, give it to me, go.
No.
That's my.
That involves our risk committee, that involves security, and the department head.
I love asking you questions, by the way, so I'll keep asking if no one else wants to chime in.
Back yourself out, kiddo.
Okay, so another little question. I've noticed this not only at BronyCon, but at a couple other cons, there have been people who have wanted to sell these variety of plushies, and it looks like every time they do, like, someone comes in and shuts them down.
These are the Chinese knockoffs.
The Chinese knockoffs. Is that specifically because they're so close to Hasbro, and that's kind of like you're just being prevented from kicking those people out? Or
no.
Because they were not made in America.
Our vendor took a stance this year on the Chinese knockoff plushies. Mainly it's protection issue, not only for ourselves, but mainly for the vendors. Hasbro, will attend conventions. They're around. They just don't tell you.
Yeah,
they keep an eye. They always have their ears to the ground. there is the ground for everything. And so cons are starting to take that stance because they, you know, some cons can't take the hit. You know, at the end of the day, we're going to protect our vendors, but we need to protect our vendors and also protect ourselves. Otherwise, you know,
yeah,
we can't be around next year. There's going to be a lot of disappointed people.
I'll be fine. There are other conventions we can go to. It's fine.
I just didn't know if that was like that specific merch was just like.
Yeah, it wasn't because we were just like, no. It was just like, okay, we need to actually take a stance on this. And it was all up to Fire Envy and Trucker, who are the vendors team. I'm a little light on the issue, mainly. I was just part of a couple of email chains, but they're the ones who made the decision. I don't like when you have that smile.
All right, this question is from Jade Aurora. Ask him if he's absolutely sure about the answer to that fur pop.
Of course he said that.
Hey!
Thank God it turned into Ask the Furry panel.
Well, are you absolutely sure?
We asked him about merpals, but he said no. It's
Sun Jade is sad face.
Murray Perry furries.
Okay, sad face. Got it. Let me check my emojis.
So, as for, like, Hasbro, did I wasn't wear suits? I just imagine that I could something.
Okay, all right. So, the suit thing started at Everfree 2012. Or, yeah, it was 2012 for me. Or was it 2013? It was one of them. I showed up in a suit. And I turned my badge around and I wrote Hasbro on it. And I wore sunglasses and I just ran around the con and, like, apparently people got worried. Like, they just trickled back and they were just like, Hasbro was here. I was like, yeah, they were. So then someone else told me that I should put C&D on my wrist, so. And after the first day, the second day, I made it funny. So
did
I
just
call it
the first day?
Yeah.
First day.
He's
first
making
day.
A fur
like
joke.
First day, fur pun. It's really bad. Just laugh.
No.
And
do that shit.
That's what I thought I heard, all right?
Throw tape at you.
Bring it.
Throw mayonnaise.
It was a different time than Fulmer and I would go to conventions wearing suits, that's for sure.
Oh, man. Yeah, those days.
I wouldn't say those were the days, because the first time we did it was all you and Well. Those were days.
Those
were fun. Actually, as a person who wasn't there and didn't have any, you know.
I organized the Harlem Shake for you.
You did, and I loved it.
God.
Too bad Saber Spark and Race Pass did another one. It took, like, took all my views.
What's them?
I had it first. I love them all to death. I love both of them.
You had it first.
I did it first.
Oh, God.
How's them apples?
You want a yiff?
No, he goes as a bear.
Oh, God.
Obviously.
This is... this is...
Oh, Abel's the one who asked the question about a furry, too.
Yes.
It started.
Yeah, hi. You're welcome.
Okay, so the arcade.
Yeah.
That was...
I need to get back on
the
kind
of surprised me, because apparently you guys got all those cameras and all those monitors.
Of course he would.
Series of laptops. That seems like a huge amount of additional money. It seems to me like it would be a huge amount of additional money.
So the arcade is actually done by the Nexus Gaming Alliance. So we didn't purchase all of that equipment.
Okay.
It was actually not even volunteer. Well, kind of volunteer, but we contracted them.
Yeah, they're contracted.
So they rented.
Well, so Nexus Gaming Alliance is a group that does gaming rooms for conventions. They've been doing conventions since 2004, 2003. They do things like Gen Con. They have a huge list on their website of conventions that they do. The owner actually ran a pony convention at one point. It was their first pony convention. I forget which one. It was one of the ones that is no longer around. I think was in Ohio. It was a Midwest one.
Canterlot Gardens.
Yeah, it wasn't
Canterlot. Oh, God.
It was another one. Midwest Brony Fest.
Oh, Midwest Brony Fest is in Kansas City one?
Yeah, Kansas City, I think.
That's still going on.
Well, he used to work for them. That's their job. Their job is going to conventions and putting on video game rooms for people. So we give them some money, we give them a hotel room, and they bring a lot of kick-ass stuff and put on a really awesome game room. Last year we used a gamer sanctuary.
I got a question. This is for Feulner from Zytor 1.
No.
Why are you not wearing a fursuit?
And Jay said, are you triple sure you're about that fursuit question?
Yeah, are you triple sure about that fursuit? About the
first Should problem? I just go get Uncle Kage in here or something? He's down to his booth now.
922.
Yeah.
So,
are you gonna answer the question or not?
Answer the question why you're not wearing a fursuit.
Yeah. Tell Zyro, do the colon and then do the V, or that weird alligator face.
Oh, hang on.
Colon capital V.
You know what a duck face?
Give him the angry eyes.
They're like face.
Oh, this face.
I'm gonna pull out my angry eyes.
Jade says that she can lend you his fursuit.
Yeah,
her fursuit.
Yeah, I mean, hell, I can lend him one.
Yes, the who suit.
The full suits are so freaking hot.
Yes, they are.
It gets so
Wait,
warm.
What?
No, not in that sense. In the whole body heat.
Uh-huh.
Question. What is your policy to mayo after last year?
It's great on sandwiches.
Great on sandwiches.
Well, if you actually paid attention, I ordered mayo for my burger yesterday.
Yes, you did. I threw it at you.
Curiosity, you weren't here when I was originally here. Where are you from?
Celestia Radio.
Celestia Radio, welcome.
Yeah. It's great.
In relation to Counterwalk Radio?
So, I mean, do you want like a legit answer on mayo? Because I can actually give you like a legit answer on mayo if you really want one.
I can do the legit answer. It's the fun one I like.
Go ahead, let's do yours.
Just don't put it on the floor. You can carry a jar of mayo. You could just walk around with a jar of mayo. I don't care.
I had a bag of pasta, and Emmy Larson signed it.
Don't have to make me pay for things.
Yeah, that was, if I remember, that was the big issue last year, was that it ended up creating a mess, and those messes cost people like us money to have to get it cleaned.
Yeah.
That was a big issue last year with everything.
We have better things to worry about. People with mayo, whatever.
Oh, so there was an issue where, not this guy specifically, but Horseshoes and some others ended up causing a small incident in one of our panels, and mayonnaise ended up on the ground, and that's really about as much as I feel comfortable saying.
Well, to be more specific, the person was just a part of the posse.
Yeah.
We were just actually going after, just to get him, just to talk to him specifically. I had two people, as well as a group, following me to the security room. And honestly, we were just focused on this guy. Because that's what we were told, it was this guy. And brought him in, and I'm kind of standing between the security door, security's just chatting with him. And two people with the Horse News Press badge had been like, oh no, he's with us. And I said, okay, he's with you guys, right? And he's like,
those
like
dumbasses.
Yeah. And I said, well, please step into my office.
Those dumbasses.
Otherwise, it would have just been him.
Oh, God. Dumbasses.
Yeah,
whose asses do I have to kick? Whose boots to the asses?
So I'm going to stop Fulner real quick here and say we have a policy not to talk to people about badge pulling or anything like that, which is where this conversation is slowly going towards. So I'm gonna cut it here. No offense, guys. I apologize.
It's okay. You can't share all the secrets.
Jade asked, will the Church of Celestia ever be allowed to hold a sermon at Bronycon?
A wedding. Jade.
Church of Celestia.
The Church of Celestia.
The first Church of Celestia we created like a couple weeks ago. Jade is the Pope.
She is?
Yeah.
This is nice.
We are a Luna family.
We are lunatics.
Oh, come on.
I am putting that down and saying you guys said it just for fun.
He said it.
Nice.
I do like.
You like Moonbutt?
Hey, you said Moonbutt, not me.
Yeah. Yes.
So, to your knowledge, Money and Logistics Society, are there any special guests who just don't want to do BronyCons or not interested at all?
As in, like, pony conventions or BronyCons specifically?
Pony conventions in general. They basically just put the blankets in and we don't care, we don't want to.
I don't think we've ever had anybody say we don't care. I think there are maybe one or two people who are done with the pony convention scene. Not gonna name names because it's not worth it, and that's just petty. We totally respect the people who are like, you know what, I had a good time doing pony conventions, but I'm gonna do other things now. But it's just maybe it's just like a couple.
Would you say that's what they are?
wouldn't, but you would. That's okay. I mean, the nice thing about these events is there is a varied amount of people who work on everything MLP branding wise that love to come to these things. Keeps it really nice and varied from year to year.
Yeah, when is Mike Vogel going to be a guest?
Well, that was
weird outcoming.
Oh man! So I actually have a funny story regarding that. So for those of you who remembered when the Weird Al episode came out. I worked with my head of PR, sort of, to we totally did coordinate on this.
Yeah. I just don't want to admit it.
we did a tweet where we kind of blasted Weird Al and told people if people wanted to see Weird Al, they should totally tell him that he should come to Bronycon. Because, I mean, Al is a tough guy to get a hold of because he has all his concerts.
Yeah.
And his agents have him super, super busy with all of his tours and everything. So it was one of those things where I was like, oh yeah, so if you want to see Weird Al at Bronycon, tweet him saying, we want to see you at Bronycon, because we figured, get put the idea in his head. And they did. Holy crap, did they ever. Occasionally, we still see it a little bit, and I still feel super bad about it. especially in a world where, in an online world where people would probably consider that harassment if it was just like normal people and not PR people running a Twitter account, I feel super bad. It's one of those things where it's in hindsight, never doing that again.
You ask the internet to solve a problem for you.
No Twitter blast.
You can't be sad about how it solved the problem.
Yeah. Handed it off to the Parasites.
But I will say, Weird Al has been considered for BronyCon. Weird Al's band has both in different variations have been considered. Definitely just not something we were able to work out this year.
Okay. Keep an eye on the sky.
Now, if William Shatner's on the show, will you try to get him?
Shatner's a brony. I mean, he's definitely welcome to come to our event at any time.
Well, Jim's trying to get him on the show.
I saw that tweet this
he's been retweeting like the pictures like nobody's the Shatner made me do it hashtag.
Well, if I remember correctly, that's how Al came about. Was a very similar thing.
It was that YouTube video from Flourish I also did.
So who knows? Clearly stranger things have happened.
Oh yeah.
In fact, someone might say weirder things have happened.
I'm so happy about this picture.
What picture is it?
The when security needs us, we play rock, paper,
yep.
scissors. You gotta go and bust like rock, paper, scissors. I'm retweeting that one.
All right.
I'm sorry, that deserves a retweet.
Yes!
High fives for me.
It looks like we're just a little short or on time here. I think there's another press session, not right up against us, but
Nicole's like an hour.
Nicole Oliver's at one.
So let's do like maybe 15 more minutes, and then Fuller and I should probably get back out on the floor. Well,
in his fursuit.
And he was
fursuit. Can I ask a more legitimate question?
Please, I actually thought that's what most things would be.
Oh heck no,
dude.
We
were having fun anyway.
For the vendor hall, what I've been getting from a lot of people so far is that there was some sort of issue, not with the convention staff. Hall staff with like the union labor for unloading and putting out gear into the vendor hall. Apparently, there was some sort of weight when it came to unloading cars. Apparently, like they could only have like 7 at a time. It was stacked up for anywhere between a minimum of a half hour to about an hour and a half to 2 hours. Just so you know that. Also, apparently, there was a burning poop smell in the unloading area.
That's Baltimore.
Yeah.
I mean, loading docks are never exactly, you know, Febreze fresh.
But yeah, they're just so you know, there seems to have been like some generic issues with.
I've been made aware of that. I mean, unfortunately, with unions are unions. We have to play by their rules.
Thanks,
more than
Jimmy.
Anything. It was a thing that happened. It sucks. We can possibly coordinate a little bit better next year, but
try to push for some more staff. I think it was just basically basically.
We can't do that. No, we cannot do that.
It's a union.
Lodens actually have very specific rules because of that. They need to follow specific union guidelines in order for everybody to, you know, again, kind of be on the safe side of legality and everything in terms of safety. So typically what we work out is if you have, like, enough to carry your hands on your own, it's fine. If you have to bring in anything that you have to roll, like on, say, like a forklift or a dolly, that needs to be handled by unions. And depending on what, in years past, depending on how much it is, there's a small fee. This year we covered, with the exception of RSALI, we covered basic union services, so little bits and things here and there that we'll cover so they don't, our vendors don't have to pay for the union fees.
Yeah, that was a big plus that I got from not the artists, but the people who were registered as some sort of
the island booth people, like the big vendors.
Well, those
not
those
just
good.
The big vendors, but the ones who were not selling artwork. Not,
yeah.
No. Yeah. Just the
selling merchandise.
Yeah.
Okay.
All the regular merchandise guys, because they purchased, because you had that stuff bundled in. That's
yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. It makes everybody's lives a little easier.
Because then they don't have to work directly with the third-party companies, because we have a company for power, we have the union for labor, and then for wireless, there's another one. So we kind of take a little bit of the brunt work to take care of the vendors that way. It's kind of one of those things where...
Which is basically what the point of the con is.
It's a balancing scale. Like, we can do super awesome, but of course there's going to be a couple of negatives that can kind of weigh on a little bit more. But I'm glad most of the vendors received that bubble thing as well. Unfortunately, with the slow load, and that it's a little bit of a disappointment, but we can see what we can do.
Question: any guys going to any conventions this year that we can probably say hi? So.
I have one more convention this year, and that'll be Ponyville Cider Fest, because I live in Milwaukee, and that's a Milwaukee event. I can't do Nightmare Nights Dallas.
Why not?
Because I have a wedding that week.
Okay, that's
an usher.
Is it your wedding?
It's not. It's in fact the chair of Ponyville Cider Fest. He's getting married to his fiance, Lucy.
First year to Celeste, you can do it.
No, why don't you Capper? He's a ordained minister for the United Unitarian Church.
Universal White Church here. Yeah. Yeah, I've got my certificate in the car.
Can you marry me in my Twilight plushie?
Oh.
Hang on. Just keep that face. That is beautiful. Hang on.
But,
that's already happened. There's that one dude here.
I am not pleased.
So, I have Nightmare Nights Dallas.
Yes.
So, I will be at Nightmare Nights Dallas. One, if I don't go,
you are local.
I will receive the wrath of Bob and Sandy because I live 10 minutes away.
And Horse News.
And Bronyville.
Hey, I'm going.
I don't care about you.
So
I can get more beer cans thrown at me and just then the George Bush.
And more pineapples.
It's kind of like how I can't not go to Cider Fest.
And then you had a question.
I don't know if this is covered since I came in late. After next year, Oticon, which has been here for so many years, is now going to be moving out. I think they said some kind of thing with the convention center. Is Bronycon moving as well, or are they still staying put?
So I love answering this one because I've done it several times on Twitter.
Listen to that stroking of the ego. I love saying that to you when you get so excited. I'm sorry.
It's true. So yeah, in fact, I'm pretty sure this was Oticon's last year. Next year.
Next year will be its
16th.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Perfect. Yes. So long story short, we're not leaving Baltimore. I have hard dates for Bronycon through 2019.
Wow.
The show will be dead before then.
I have soft dates for Bronycon through 2025. Wow. Now, when I say hard dates, I mean we have a letter of intent with the city of Baltimore that we will be having our convention here with those dates in mind. Not those dates in mind, with those dates exactly. For 2021, 2, 3, 4, 5, we are penciled in with dates so that our space can be held at the Baltimore Convention, here at the Baltimore Convention Center.
Wow.
So we intend to be here. As long as people keep coming, we're going on, and we're going to keep growing.
Can you say what next year's date will be, or do you wait until a certain time to release that?
We're going to talk about that at closing ceremonies.
Oh, okay.
But yes, we do have next year's dates.
There's sometime next year.
I have a question. I noticed something about the fandom and the conventions, and that what sometimes tends to happen is that the popularity in the cultural settings as to it getting paid attention to by culture, when that sort of seems to go down, it coincides with the population going down. But it seemed, according to last year's con, where the con didn't seem to get that much popular culture attention, what actually happened was the Brony population was growing, and it seems to even continue to grow. And I noticed that this con again, you're getting popular culture attention again. By one of the ways to mark that is the fact that you've got big name back. Is it? So then the question is, were there no big names, let's say, as guest of honors last year at the con? Was that because of scheduling, or was that because you think that maybe they felt the con wasn't something that they was losing interest or were losing popularity, and that maybe it's gaining popularity again so they can come back?
Big names, I mean, I think I understand what you're saying by that. That's a really relative term to everybody.
Sure.
I mean, we always go through our agents for the show guests as well as others. And we always plan the type of event that we want and the type of guests we want to see that year. Sometimes some people can't come that we are intended to. It's not because of something being unpopular or anything. But, I mean, if you look at all the people who work on this IP, they have very busy schedules. And sometimes it just doesn't necessarily work. Occasionally it might be that they're at another convention, but a lot of times it's they're working on things that aren't even My Little Pony, because My Little Pony is only a fraction of the type of things they work on.
Like Peter News, the Pillsbury Doughboy. So.
Is he really?
Yeah.
All right.
What?
This question comes from Jade Aurora.
I'm going to poke him in the belly.
Well, hey, I apologize. I just want to make sure I answer your question.
Thanks. I've been writing about Bronies and Bronycon for a while, and there's something really special, very fascinating about this community, is that when it first started, it got so much attention by popular culture media and popular culture outlets, and then that seemed to dissipate. That usually coincides with a fandom losing its numbers and losing its popularity.
And yet the opposite seems to be happening.
And the opposite is completely happening. I think that the Bronies are actually formulaic to prove that a different way can exist from within the popular culture industry that actually challenges these normative standards and still can continue to grow without needing to feed the monster, so to speak, of like media and popular culture. We seem to be doing just fine without it. And I guess it was a scheduling issue, because I'm glad to hear that. But it doesn't seem to interrupt the life of this community and its growth in how it's being connected to the outer world. And I think that because it thrives and continues to grow regardless of their attention, they're starting to notice this again.
I think a lot of the reasons why a lot of the explosive growth towards the beginning of the fandom, say let's talk 2010 through late 2012,
right.
A lot of it had to do with shock factor to outside populace. Obviously, to anybody who's been around, it's just like, it's just a show. We like a show. Really goes about as far as that. But to everybody else, you know, it was very awkward, because the idea of having a show that kind of breaks the gender normative standard for this is a show for girls, boys like it too. Something like that didn't quite exist to the prevalence before that. I think that attributes to a lot of the initial culture shock growth of everything. We still see a lot of that right now, but it's less because of, hey, this is weird, and more because, hey, this is interesting. So we see...
Time for rock, paper, scissors.
Nope.
Yeah, yeah, there
it is. I was like, alright, let's do this.
Apple cider asks, what are the elements of good cheer?
So we see a lot more people who chose not to touch things towards the beginning because of the fact that there was the stigma towards it. That stigma has slowly kind of washed away as the years have gone on. And now we see a lot of people, a lot of news outlets, a lot of pop culture stuff continuing to embrace it more and more, whereas they kind of wanted to shy away from the beginning just due to being leery. I mean, I can tell you for right now, some of the interesting press outlets that we see this weekend outside of, you know, the pony fandom, we have CNN here this weekend. We have
WWE.
We have WWE is here this weekend.
Yeah.
We have Rolling Stone is here as well.
John Cena!
And
they come back next year. Take them to my street party.
You have The Atlantic and Playboy write these fantastic articles that are really well written and true to the fandom. It wasn't sensationalist at all.
And the best part of that is that continues to feed into it. People's curiosity beforehand were like, maybe not. Now they generally become more opening towards it. And when you kind of look at these events that continue to grow in spite of that, you need to kind of remember that, you know, what you see here now is only a small fraction of what actually exists in general. There are millions and millions of people who are into this sort of thing around the world.
And one of the things to play off that, I had a thing when I first came to Baltimore early. I was doing a personal work thing. I went to a rental car agency and the guy was asking me where I was going. I was like, oh, I'm here for work, but I'm also here for a conference. And, you know, that's kind of my default answer, just, you know, conference, because I know that they're going to ask. And they're like, oh, what's happening at the convention center this weekend? And I said, oh, Bronycon. He's like, oh, the name's familiar. Do you want to run that by me? Like, what do you guys do? And I was like, well, it's going to sound weird, but I'm going to tell you it's not. So I explained. He's like, oh, yeah. And he kind of went into it. He says that when he first found out about Bronies, he hated it. He thought it was dumb, it was stupid. But then he was like, I watched the Netflix documentary,
right.
And he was like, I 180. Now that I understand, it's just people going to see other people, have fun, and just, like, be awesome. It's cool. Like, there's no judgment now. I was like, that's really, really awesome to hear.
Yeah. You think that'd be the point of a convention as a whole?
Correct. You had your hand up for a while.
So I'm going to take this and turn it a little bit on its head.
Did a short one just because we're past the time limit now,
yeah,
so
just
they do need to get going.
Okay, so that's all the good press. What about people who are going to be pushing bad press intentionally, like
Horse News,
Howard Stern show, or something like the, us and the National Review, where we got called terrorists?
Oh, called terrorists? What?
Howard Stern, and you don't necessarily count because as you and I have discussed in private. At your best, you guys get to be the Onion for My Little Pony.
Okay, what do we get? We got the Onion, the TMZ, the Fox News.
I wouldn't put you as
Fox
News. But
unlike Fox News, you tell the truth.
But
thank you.
Nice.
So it's really interesting because negative press, by and large, ultimately, for whatever reason, tends to bounce off this fandom pretty well, and it just becomes additional press. It's one of those things where, like, there's no such thing as bad press. That's not necessarily true, typically. But, like, things with Howard Stern. Are they here this weekend outside?
Not that I've seen.
That's
a
first.
Sure they are.
I was going to say, that is
it's not Fox. Well, it's not Fox News. It's a local Fox station.
Well, no. I'm
talking
about
WBFF,
Howard Stern,
yeah.
Because Howard Stern has been coming to our event in some capacity or another since 2012.
Yeah.
But our fandom tends to take that and just laugh it off because we all know better. And it's the scale of which there is bad press versus good press is very marginal. So the good always tends to win out for everybody by and large. And the people who tend to come and say, I'm going to go to this and it's probably going to be terrible, ultimately end up coming and say, I had a great time. We had Jezebel come last year and they came in with some preconceived notions of what they would find. And they completely 180, like on the day one of the event, and had a fantastic time. They said it wasn't for them, but they totally understood why everybody seems to love it.
Quick question. I need your waifus, gentlemen.
I told you this is Josh Dean.
My waifu.
Oh, well, it's a mutual thing. Okay.
My cell phone.
His cell phone is his waifu. Last question for Sirius.
Yes. This last question is kind of more like me planting an evil idea in your head, but I know it's not reality at all. What would be the possibility of one day BronyCon becoming like the equivalent of like the International Olympic Committee, in that you guys go in and say, like, vie for certain places to host the next BronyCon, and they go around like, yes, this time it's going to be San Francisco.
Yes, so we're all going to go to Qatar.
That causes way too much work.
Yeah. So to feed into that and actually give the real answer, there's a reason why, not the real answer, but to be more in-depth answer. Moving from city to city,
it's costly and hard and time-consuming.
Yes, but for reasons that people don't necessarily expect. When you go to a city, you have new relationships you have to build and forge with those cities, with convention centers, with hotels, with unions. And if you go from city to city, you're basically just having to 100% start from scratch year to year. And when we did New York to Secaucus and then to Baltimore, that first year in Baltimore, it was very rough because we didn't necessarily know 100% what we were doing. I mean, to be fair, I don't think anyone really does. We're all adults. We make it up as we go along. That's the greatest secret of being an adult. But it's when you work with the same people year after year after year, you build a rapport with them. They know what to expect from you. You know what to expect from them. It makes all of those types of scheduling things that much easier. A lot of the things that you see around Baltimore in terms of our signage, in terms of our stickers, everywhere around the city, would not exist